Hey everyone, welcome to Disorganized Play. I am your disorganized player. Well, one of those things is true. I'm Tom Lommel, I'm your host. I am the at Dungeon Bastard. Every week I run a game live on Saving Throw Show called the Iron Keep Chronicles. Every Tuesday we get together, talk about what's going to happen that week. Every Wednesday we play, other things happen, and every Thursday I get together and talk a little bit about what happened in that session, what changed, what could have gone better, what went well, what didn't go well, and I also talk about some of my own personal GM philosophy and advice. So, welcome to it, everyone. Thank you so much for joining me today, and I know my shirt is wrinkled. I'm sorry, guys. I didn't have a chance to iron before I got to my... Well, I mean, I had a chance. I just don't... I don't care enough about you people. That's the cold, hard truth. No, I don't care about myself enough is the cold, hard truth. You know what? I don't care about my clothes hard enough. My wife will confirm that. Mm-hmm. She's here. She's not feeling well. All right. So, there we go. Very good. Thank you so much for tuning in. I can take the shirt off, but that's against Twitch streaming policy. So, you're just going to have to suffer, everyone. Very good. What's on deck today? A couple things. We're talking about pacing. Banging the gavel. I don't know if you have all had a chance to watch last night's session, but it very prominently featured a gavel. Speaking of which, it also prominently featured... oink, 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 a courtroom scene. We're going to talk about that a little bit. Thirdly, we're going to talk about White Plume Mountain and breaking the rules. Hey, everyone, I read the module yesterday. You know, might be helpful before you actually run it. There we go. So we're going to talk about White Plume Mountain and breaking the rules. And then finally, if we have time, hopefully we'll have time, we're going to talk about the reward zone. Obviously, the chat rewards were a little bit different last night. I thought they worked well, but I wanted to discuss it with you all at home a little bit. So thanks so much, everyone, for the... thanks so much, everyone, for the nice comments about the game last night. To do a brief recap, I thought it went very well. I thought it turned into more of a role-playing session than I expected. That's okay. Yeah, so in terms of like the arc of the session, I thought the courtroom scene that we were a little slow getting into it. It was hard to get everybody zeroed in and focused on the game. It was hard to clarify for everyone what the timeline was of what had happened and where everybody was and when who was together. And then you have that whole thing where it's like, how do we juggle? Like, I want to do something, but are they there? Are they not there? Et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So I thought we got off to a little bit of a, you know, it was a rocky start, which of course is going to happen when half the party wasn't there the week before, right? Whereas you feel like you have to explain a little bit. And also we were doing a time jump. I think I probably could have cleaned that up by having sort of an intro written. I was like, boom, okay. And then kind of laid it out for them. They could read it and absorb it and go, okay, well that squares with, that makes sense. Rather than kind of half listening, and then when you do it more free form, when you don't have it scripted, you do it more free form, then the players feel like, okay, well, let me jump in, and I wanted to do this, and oh, by the way, and wait a minute, when that happened, is this, you know, they have a lot more questions, and it feels like more of a, oh, we're not recapping, we're playing through this, so I want to make sure that I get my turn, take my turn, do my thing, whatever it is, right? Which is fine. I'm just saying you can short circuit some of that kind of disjointedness that we had last night by just writing up two paragraphs of intro, in summary, here we go, here's what happened, etc. That would have helped. I didn't do that. Like a lot of my advice, listen to what I say, watch and learn from my mistakes. So that was interesting. That was sort of a we stumbled a little bit out of the blocks. Then we got into the courtroom scene. I thought that went extremely well. It was fun to role play. We're going to talk about courtroom scenes in a minute, you know, in a couple minutes. So I don't want to go super deep on it. Then the next piece of it, which was sort of this, there was this whole thing injected by Amy's character of like, I want my mummer's wagon back, which I didn't, like, I sort of anticipated, but I didn't have a good plan for dealing with. And then also we're back at sort of loggerheads where the rest of the party is like, you're going to get us in trouble. We want to fight you on this. Which is natural, and that's understandable. So that was a little bit that was a little bit disjointed as well, I thought. And then actually getting up to the Iron Keep and getting into White Plume Mountain, I didn't feel like I had that stuff nailed down. So it was a little bit kind of finding our way in the dark a little bit. I don't know whether the players noticed that or not. It doesn't really matter. We got there, and then we got onto the quest. So there's some things that I think we need to do with White Plume Mountain to zero it in and make it more or better integrated into our campaign. We'll talk about that on Tuesday. So, yeah, I think Eric's, you know, Grayson's question for Belloc was interesting, and I think the Thieves Guild quest, you know, if Averell can remember it, I think will provide interesting motivation for her. I think we need to spend some time on Tuesday talking about ways that we can integrate the rest of the party and the rest of the dungeon into a more organic experience, because right now it feels very old school AD&D. And that's not really the mode that we have been playing the campaign in, or the way the campaign has been shaped is a little more freeform RP, and White Plume Mountain is just so five rooms of encounters and over. You know, it's very clearly, like, it feels like a tournament module. I don't know that it wasn't written expressly to be one, but it could certainly be used as one. And it's more of a, like, a not a one-shot, but like a three-shot, maybe a two-shot. Rather than I feel like it's an adventure. There's, the plot is the most elemental plot possible, which is there's three MacGuffins in the dungeon. Go find as many as you want. Good luck getting out. Right? So that's fine. That's what it is. Let's deal with that and see how we can bring the material that's been presented to us more in line with the players' expectations and what we want to evoke from both the players and the material, right? And in terms of, like, what's going on in an overall, like, campaign arc, and also kind of where we're headed, because White Plume Mountain is a lot shorter than Sunless Citadel, which, no strikes against that, but that means, like, this is going to be dealt with in fairly short order, given the fact that we're probably not going to have another bunch of huge role-playing scenes, most likely. I mean, I want to try and work some in, but it's not built into, there's no Meepo encounter, right, for the most part. You know, Sunless Citadel doesn't have a ton of role-playing expressly written into it, but we certainly injected that and created a dynamic for that by making the kobolds friendly. There might be some potential for that in White Plume Mountain. Well, maybe, we're not going to talk about that very much today. We'll talk about that more on Tuesday. So, that's a recap. I thought overall it was a great session, and I'm glad we got to the riddles. That was our final session. We finally got into White Plume Mountain and explained this bizarre, you know, geography of the labyrinth, and then had the riddle session. And there were some moments where it's like, okay, well, everybody's just silently staring at their paper, and I'm familiar with that sort of thing from running and playing Nazcrag. But I know it doesn't make the greatest camera experience, but hopefully, you know, you all had fun working on those riddles in chat too. I haven't gone back and watched what chat was doing during that particular segment. But I thought the riddles really worked well. I didn't think they were too hard, and that's always that fine balancing point where, of course, one or two of them have to be easy, or it's fine for one or two of them to be easy. But then you need to have a couple that it's like, oh boy, I really got to think about this, just so that people have the satisfaction of having solved it. Because if they're all too easy, then it doesn't feel like a challenge. They don't feel like they've earned a victory, right? It doesn't feel like much, you know, the gatekeeper Sphinx has really done much of its job. So, the orc riddle, there's two different possibilities there, and you can either do 87 or you can do 78, and it really is a matter of how you interpret that puzzle. I think both answers are acceptable, except that when you plug 78 into the equation, it looks like 8L. It doesn't look like an 8 and a number. So that's a little bit tricky, but I think it's fine to have a puzzle like that then requires you to that where it has two acceptable answers. I think that's okay. I don't think some is, I think that's a little too easy. That's a little too, that's a classic misdirection riddle that we've seen so many times before that I wouldn't accept that as an acceptable, I wouldn't find that an acceptable answer unless the party was really bogged down and are just given up on the whole thing. And where they're like, I don't know. But that raises an interesting point, which is, it's okay to have a riddle that has multiple solutions. It doesn't have to have just one. That's actually not a bad option, is to have a couple different solutions. And you go, okay, well, I can see it that way. Or, if it's too weird and too vague, but that's okay. Yeah, it's usually a picture. James V. points out that riddle is usually a picture, and I think it's too easy as a picture. So I made it a little tougher that way. That's my prerogative. All right, so that is our agenda for today. I want to talk about a couple. I've got so many different things to cover. I'm going to let's dive into the meat of it, shall we? Let's grab the beating heart of this wild bucking bronco that we call disorganized play and ride forth into the arena and see if we get kicked off. All right. So, pacing and banging the gavel. So, something that I think is an important GM skill to master, and I don't know that I often say you have to master this, but I feel like this is one of those things that you do have to master if you want to regularly run a successful game, and that is to constantly be monitoring the pacing and knowing when to give the player some slack and let them discuss or sidebar or role play or whatever it is that they're doing on their end, deliberate, and then when to reel them in and kind of cut short that debate, cut off that we've talked about this and all right, so you decide to or push them to at least a decision point. Do you want to head north up the jagged trail under the rocky crags, or do you want to go around the bend here and explore the cave? You can pull them out of amorphous deliberation mode and get them focused on, okay, let's get a decision going. But regardless, the general point is you need to be able to monitor, manage, adjust the pace of the game. And in a home game, it's certainly lower stakes, and it's easy to let the players have a lot of rope and let them do kind of whatever they want. especially when you're streaming, when you're performing for a streaming audience, that can get dangerous. You can go just drift off into sidebar territory and kind of go all over the place, and you know, the audience loses interest and whatnot. I'm not going to get into a big debate about, like, oh, these are your best practices when streaming, because I don't think that's helpful for you running your game at home. Sure, it's great to, like, pick your brain about, like, oh, okay, well, this was a sort of a slow moment of the game, or this was fun, or I enjoyed watching this, or whatever, right? But I don't want to specifically dial this advice into, like, here's the best way to DM when you're streaming, because I really think it's a similar set of skills, but it's happening in a different context and with an audience watching, and you know, there's also the pressure of, like, you want to try and get your viewer numbers up and all that kind of garbage that you don't have to worry about when you're running a regular game of D&D. So let's not talk. We can talk about that at a different time or on a panel or something like that. That's fine. But your main tools to doing this, or that main tools that you need to consider this, is number one, and this is just a general DM skill that is required of a DM. In order to manage pacing, in order to run a successful game, not just beyond running a game that has good pacing, you have to pay attention. Like, that's your number one. Is that your number one job? That is more important than having prepared material. That seems like a bold thing to say, but you can improvise a very engaging, very exciting roller coaster adventure just by listening to what your players are talking about and then processing and reflecting that back at them. I've talked about that before. If you have incredibly well-prepared notes and you're not paying attention to what your players are doing, saying, deliberating about where they're at in terms of paying attention to the game, paying attention to each other, in their life, at the table, etc., then it doesn't matter whether you have read all 256 pages of Storm King's Thunder and printed off 6 different articles from PowerScore blog about the best way to run it and all of your different options. If you lose the players, you've lost the game, right? So your number one skill is you have to pay attention. The other thing that I think you need to do is obviously in pacing, you need to have an eye on the clock versus an eye on the material in front of you, right? And I know in my own personal experience, I've fallen short in this respect in terms of, it's very easy to go, well, and then in this room there's these, you know, there's a combat that we need to, or that we're gonna address, solve, encounter, da da da, whatever it is. And that gets out of hand, right? That ends up taking 3 hours or 2 hours or whatever it is. I mean, fortunately, in a lot of our games on stream, sure, there's the big boss combat that we'll have that will take the whole session, but a lot of times it's like, well, this will take an hour and then we get out of it or whatever. So, but that's the number one way that I have fallen short, is I go, oh, well, we really need to finish this. Like, let's just push on for another hour, right? So that's where things get, like, weird and funny and fungible. You start straining players' attention span. You know, real life constraints come in, or somebody has to go, or they got work the next day, or whatever it is, right? So you have to be paying attention to the involvement and engagement of the players, read the table, know what's going on mood-wise and attention-wise, and then secondly, know what some of your outs are in terms of, if we get to here, that's it. Even last night, I was sort of pushing the pace where it was like 10 to 11, and I wasn't sure how much longer this was going to go, but I was like, let's get over this hump of, like, let's get this Sphinx. Like, I'm looking at the material going, is the Sphinx, like, could I walk them up to the Sphinx and then cliffhanger it? Or could we have the Sphinx interaction, which I think would be a great kind of, like, neat, fairly concise encounter. Certainly more than 15 minutes, though. We have that and then cliffhanger it, right? So once you are paying attention, monitoring what's going on, trying to balance the material you have in front of you against the inevitable sidetracks and diversions that they want to, they're going to introduce and they're going to go off on. There's a couple different techniques that you can use to help manage this stuff, right? And so, like, last night, the big one that was deployed, or maybe the most noticeable one that was deployed, was banging the gavel. And I think that that doesn't literally have to be what you do, right? Like, that was a very... It was in character, it was in scene, so it really worked, and it had a lot of power. I don't know that I would recommend it for just I'm the GM, clonk, clonk, clonk. That seems a little bit onerous and dickish. But you can do that in a less ostentatious way. So you can have an NPC interrupt. You can have an NPC interject into the discussion that the players are having. That's why it's... You know, one of your the key tools in your toolbox is if you can have that. I don't want to call them like a Clubet NPC, but you have that ride along helper character who can say something, notice something, encounter something, redirect the stream of conversation, the focus. Even if it's just something like, so in one of my home games, the party has like a at least one, if not a couple different animal companions, right? One of them is a bear, right? That bear can sniff something, see something, go off and, you know, start wandering off, growl at something. The bear can roll around and be like, oh, I'm bored, you know, that whole sort of thing. Well, that suddenly takes the players out of the world of them, that just it's just them talking, and the rest of the game is sort of on pause, right? Which is how a lot of players treat that sort of sidebar conversation. Is everything is doing, you know, everything is going. The players like make camp or whatever, and then the rest of the world is just sort of on pause, and they have their big discussion about, oh, here's our planning session or whatever they're gonna do. And they feel like, well, we don't have to worry about anything that's going on the DM side of the screen at this point. Okay, that's fine. I get how it's easy to fall into that. But one of your tools that you can use as the DM is you can make sure, remind them, no, the world has not stopped. Help prompt them to do that. So you can have an NPC interrupt. You can just, like, redirect them with a question. Like I said earlier, do you want to do this, whatever. You can redirect them simply by calling, you know, for a roll for initiative or calling for a skill check. So you can have the game mechanics interrupt the players, bring the game back into focus. Either roll for initiative. Oh, wait, well, combat is happening. Okay, well, let's get our, you know, we're in danger. Get our head in the game, everybody. Or make a skill check. Oh, okay. Oh, wait a minute. What was that about? Well, can I make one of those? Can I? What did you find out? Okay. It's an avenue for introducing new information or for putting kind of some precision on, putting a pointed direction on a piece of information. So, I don't have a lot more to say about pacing and banging the gavel, but I think it was one of the things that was very forward in my mind last night. And sometimes I'm sitting there behind the screen going, I want them to be able to find the solution here, right? It shouldn't be too obvious. Like if you watched last night with the moon key, right? That scene, I don't think it fumbled a lot, but there, it was definitely a sense of the players were like, I'm kind of poking the water with my 10-foot pole here, and I'm trying to see if I can hit bottom or hit something solid. And I didn't want it to be like, oh, the first thing you do is walk up to where the portcullis is, and there's a magical portal there, and you just walk through. There had to be more to it. And I had set up, I thought, that there was more to it, but that had slipped their minds. That's fine. we found our way out of it, right? So, you know, the beauty there is Amy's playing around with her mummer's card and decides to move the scene forward by trying to invoke the voice again. All right, great. Yeah, as BSB Care points out, I can't make the solution too obvious because otherwise this whole idea that the place has been abandoned and that nobody's been there in forever, that goes out the window, right? So, it had to be something that was unusual, fantastic. And that's something that I feel like it's been a design principle that I have started chasing more and more and more over the past 3 to 5 years is let's really embrace the, or I personally want to really embrace the fantastic aspects of Dungeons and Dragons. I don't want to, you know, create a very mundane, low magic, everyday, grim and gritty type of milieu where the most exciting thing that happens to you is that there's a bread shortage or whatever it is, right? Like, I get that campaign. I understand that people want to play that playstyle. That, for me, I want to think on a different... I want to operate on a different scale. So that's how the whole... You know, that's why I'm like, well, let's find it together. There's got to be something, you know, going on. And I love ideas like the full moon and whatnot. BSB Care says, more Hobbit, less Game of Thrones. Yeah, definitely. Like, I think Game of Thrones is great for what it is, but it's largely a political intrigue story. And The Hobbit is definitely, like, an epic tale of fantastic adventure. So, I don't remember even how I got going on that, but there are moments where you need to, like, let the players kind of breathe and sigh and poke and explore and see if they'll take the reins. And then there are moments where it's like, okay, well, let's help funnel towards a solution. Let's work together to find that solution. Oh, okay, you're going to talk to your voices. All right, your voices have something to say. I'm not going to hand it to you, but, you know, the idea that it was in the sky, that I thought that was interesting. It got us to the point where, okay, now step one we have done. Now step two is fairly straightforward. The other thing that I will say about pacing is you have to be prepared to abandon preconceived notions or assumptions that you have about the way things are going to play out. Like, I kept trying to communicate to Havana that these two pieces of the locket, like, fit together like a Rubik's Cube, but you had to get a high enough sleight of hand roll to make them, like, fit together. And she's got a pretty good sleight of hand, but she just sort of gave up on that whole idea. Which, that's fine, but now I've got to process that. Okay, well, now what happens? Oh, okay, well, what happens is there's the two things on the door. You just, all you do is put them in. Let's abandon this idea that I'm going to make you go through this weird three-step process to da-da-da-da-da and keep, you know, oh, you didn't roll high enough. Well, let's try another re-roll or what do you get some insight about blah, blah, blah. Like, we did enough of that, and then finally it's like, okay, great, I'm going to abandon that idea, this whole thing that it turns into this magical Rubik's Cube type of deal. Get rid of that and go to the door. And it was a fun Harry Potter moment. Like, go ahead and steal from that sort of stuff as long as you put your original take on it. And also, players want to experience fun, fantastic elements like an animated picture that they have in Harry Potter without having to play through Harry Potter, right? So sometimes just lifting those types of things is a quick shortcut for them to get engaged in, oh, yeah, this is just, like, fun. Okay. Yeah, I don't know. Did the chocolate frogs hop around? You know, if you do it too much, then it just seems tired and uninspired. But if you can fill it in a way that has your spin and has some originality on it, why not steal from somebody as clever and inspiring as J.K. Rowling, right? So, that's pacing and banging the gavel. So we had a courtroom scene last night. I want to just talk briefly about it. I thought it went well. I wasn't prepped enough for it because I really just had written down, like, sort of who was on the tribunal, what they had been doing a little bit, but more or less like, okay, well, what are some punishment options here? And how is this going to go forth? And I set it up, and I was like, well, we need to actually have a courtroom scene, right? There's no... If it's just me saying, okay, then the tribunal happens, and... Okay, so, sorry about that, everyone. It's not a super hot day today, so I don't know what... I don't know what's going on, but we had a little brown out there, so I apologize for the interruption in the stream. So that's okay. I don't have a hard out today. I have some other things I have to take care of, but we'll catch up on those 15 minutes. So, or 10 minutes or whatever. Anyway, I was in the middle of talking about the courtroom scene last night. And as I said, sort of through my phone in the chat while the stream was down, I felt like it was a successful scene. I hadn't fully anticipated that it was going to happen. I had made a list of who was involved in this tribunal, like what form of justice was this going to take, what were their methods. Excuse me. And then I had a rough idea of, like, well, what would be meted out as a punishment for this, right? So that was sort of where I was at. But I think in order to have... the scene could have been more developed... and I think specifically in the following ways. So, I should probably retweet that we're back up. Whatever. Anybody on Twitter who I lost. Anyway. So... I think there's a few elements that could have made this scene a little bit richer than maybe it was presented last night. Now, that's not to say it wasn't a successful scene last night. That's not the case. But if I were to go back and design an encounter around this courtroom scene, there's a couple things that I would have done. I would have had a definite list of charges. Like, I would have had those written out ahead of time. Like, it may not have seemed like it, but I was just, or maybe it really seemed like it, but I was making those up last night, and I wasn't just making them up in order to give Havana something to write down. I was making those up, like, okay, well, what's a reasonable list of things that these people would have been charged with, and what's the seriousness of the crime, you know, et cetera, et cetera, right? So, like, I would have liked to have had actual bam-bam names that I could have just read off, like, these are the charges, actual charges could have read. That's one thing. And that tells the players, oh, they could be getting the death penalty for this or something like that, right? It informs the players, oh, they're actually being accused of betraying civilized society. Well, that's a lot bigger deal than maybe, you know, providing aid and comfort to the enemy or whatever it is, or murder in the second degree, etc. I mean, that also just, like, raises the whole issue of, do they have a justice system that's similar to what we have here in America, or is this fantasy world going to be a completely different type, different entity? There's that. So I wish I would have had a list of charges. I wish I would have had a summary, at least, of the key points of evidence that had been weighed against the defendants. That, I think, would have been helpful, so that the players would have had an idea, okay, well, these are the hooks that I can, like, pick at. You know, the whole point of having a courtroom scene like that is that there is a element of persuasion in terms of, there's an element of debate or dissection in terms of, well, these might be facts, but they might be misinterpreted, or this person might be lying, we're going to cast doubt on this, you know. dispute the premise type of that whole argumentative portion of it. But then there's also the persuasive part of it of this is a good and righteous man who was just trying to do what he thought was best. And yes, he is, you know, he maybe made some mistakes in how he went about it, but blah, 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 right? So there's the persuasive part of, like, persuading the jury. So there's the whole, like, casting doubt on the evidence portion of the trial, and then there's the whole plea to people's empathy part of it. And you can't have... We had the second half of that last night, but you can't really have the cast doubt on the body of collected evidence if you don't have a body of collected evidence. Some of it was like, okay, you're the players, you know what happened, and we have also determined what happened, so let's not regroup over facts that have already been established, right? Let's not re-explore the dungeon or the storyline here in this weird court format. Let's shorthand it a little bit and go, here's this, da-da-da. So that's one thing. And then the third thing that I probably would have done is it would have been helpful to have a witness stand with some witnesses that the players could interrogate or who could portray their version of the events, put their point of view out there so that the rest of the party can now respond like, wait a minute, what they're saying isn't true, or she might think that, but that's wrong, or hey, this guy couldn't come and bail out Torek and Pearl and provide really exculpatory testimony here. So those are the elements that I think, if I'd been a little bit sharper about the fact that this was going to happen, I would have prepared in advance so that when we have the scene, you want the players to be able to, like, to play a part of the law and order trope that is so deeply ingrained in our culture and our television and whatnot, right? So it went off successfully, but I think I could have laid the groundwork a little bit more. It could have been a fuller type of experience if I had anticipated just what an important deal that was going to be. And honestly, like, that's a pretty big DM blind spot that I missed that. That I was like, I wrote that down and I just kind of like let's... I was so focused on, like, let's get to the next adventure. Let's get to the next adventure. We just had a big role-playing thing. I don't want to have another big role-playing thing back-to-back. You've got to recognize where the players are and then, you know, pay that scene its proper due. And we owed a balance on... We had so much invested in the lives of tax parents and in the misdeeds of the mayor and what an evil person he was, that that we had to pay out. We had to give them the attention that they deserved. So I do think it, as I think somebody pointed out maybe in chat before we got fired back up, one maneuver that I was proud of, and this sort of ties into our pacing discussion, was Tack and Avril were both sort of doing this meandering, like, you know, Avril wanted to spill the beans on what had happened to the curse of the town 10 years ago. And the rest of the party was like, no, I don't, like, don't, and Amy especially wanted to defend her character from any weird kind of supernatural implications. And so she was putting the brakes on that. Going to one of the lawful good characters, especially the goody two shoes, bam, what happened 10 years ago? Let's shortcut this whole argument that's happening. Let's cut to the heart of it. And I will say, like, that is also a skill that you need to develop to be a good improviser, is to know, like, okay, how can I edit this scene that brings it to the maximum drama, that puts a character in a position where they need to make a difficult choice, and then either wriggle out of it or face it head on and see what the consequences are. So That was an interesting move. So it was a successful scene. I think if you want to deploy courtroom scenes within your game, it is important to include or prepare the elements that I just outlined, right? You need to have, I mean, on top of that, then you also need to have, like, who the victims are and who the various characters are that are involved and what's their motivation. You know, those types of scenes, this one was particularly easy to pull off because we'd spent so much time developing, okay, well, this is what kind of the nefarious plot is, and here are the personalities that are involved, and here are where the character allegiances are. They like these, you know, Tack is very defensive of her parents, and everybody wants to like her parents, but they've done something bad. Nobody likes the mayor because the mayor's an ass. Great, well, let's hang him out to dry. So that worked for us because we had done a bunch of groundwork before. If you're just going to kind of like slam a courtroom scene in there, you need to think about those aspects on top of what I mentioned earlier. So, that's my very brief take on courtroom scenes. It was just something that I was like thinking about in retrospect. Like that went well. It could have been a whole session. I think it could have been a little crisper if I had prepped a little bit more material in the way that I just talked about. So, there's that. Our next piece of the pie here. Jellicoe says, approach the setup like a lawyer would. You know, part of it is, I'm not a lawyer. So, like, for me to discover these things is like learning how to ride a bike. I'm sure to a lawyer it's obvious. It's like, yes, you dispute the premise, and you go after you find the loophole in the law, and then you make an emotional appeal to humanity or whatever it is, right? But for me to discover that, like, I have to work at discovering that because I'm not a lawyer. So it's easy to say, well, just approach it like a lawyer would. Yeah, all right. Think about what that means. Because that doesn't come naturally to me anyhow. I don't have enough experience behind the behind the bench, I guess, as you would say. All right, so I want to talk briefly about White Plume Mountain and breaking the rules. And so specifically what I want to talk about is, as I said yesterday, I read the whole module yesterday afternoon. And the main thing that struck me, obviously there's a couple different things that we can talk about in terms of the structure and all that kind of stuff. Like I said earlier, it feels like kind of a tournament module in terms of enter dungeon here, go through a series of puzzles and traps to get to treasure here, go back, da-da-da-da-da-da-da. That part of it is fine. But the other piece of it that struck me, and not just in terms of the old school structure that it has, but it has some very old school flourishes in terms of its design. And specifically, it has a number of things that are rule breaking. That's just the way it is. These ghouls wear amulets that prevent them from being turned, but the amulets only work in White Plume Mountain or whatever it is, right? Okay. Well, so I think we need to reflect on this material before we go too far down the road and just say there was a time, and you know, it continues to be a certain type of play style where it's the GM versus the players. But certainly very early on in AD&D's history, like one of the more novel experiences was to go to a convention and play in a tournament. Like now we have Adventurers League, it's like going to a store and playing D&D doesn't seem like such a weird thing, or you know, playing with strangers or whatever, right? But back then, like, it was a big deal to kind of like show how much you knew about the rules, how powerful and advanced your character was, how much prowess you had. And of course, you know, back in that time period too, like you had some people had the opportunity to like stake out pieces of the D&D world. You know, a lot of the Greyhawk campaign, those early campaigns, were different players going through Gary's campaign and saying, I have conquered this much territory on your map. I'm going to send my guards around to patrol, and I'm going to start building a stronghold, and I'm going to call it Keoland or whatever it is, right? So, as this accumulation of wealth, power, it's not just character wealth and character power, but there's also like a certain level of rules mastery that begins to, you know, gets developed, right? And then, you know, that what comes along with that is mastery of rules loopholes. So at some point, AD&D started to become a battle of who knew the rules best and who could exploit them in the most clever way. And then you fixed that by either adding errata and changing the way that erasing those loopholes, or you fixed it in the way that White Plume Mountain does, which is, fuck your rules, I'm the DM, it works this way because I said so. You can't turn these guys. You try to turn them, nothing happens. Why? I don't have to tell you why. You don't know. That's just the way it works. I'm not a fan of this approach. I don't think, like, I think it's okay to surprise your players. And I think it's okay to paste over a rules loophole or close off or cut off a rules loophole. And it's especially okay to do that, like, in conjunction with the players, having a discussion with them, right? And it's okay to sometimes like temporarily nerf someone and say, well, I don't understand why that's not happening right now. But I think your players are owed a better explanation than because I said so. Or there's something weird about this place. Which, like, as BSB Care points out, like, I'm using that excuse, like, you're in this extra-dimensional space, but I think you have to pay it out kind of, like, beyond that, and also that, when we had the battle in the other pocket dimension, in the Sunless Citadel place, right, it wasn't just a thing that was like, oh, well, I'm screwing you so that I can take your toys away. There were also advantages. They were able to manipulate the monsters and the environment because they were in this space. So it was an advantage and a disadvantage. It wasn't just the DM going, well, I don't like that anymore, so I'm not doing that. Like, that doesn't work. And I think when you break the rules in this type of heavy-handed fashion, you can do it if your players have an understanding that you're going to do that, or that you're doing it in the interest of some sort of fairness. But more often than not, especially when you don't give them justification for it, or a way that they feel like they can then manipulate the situation or accept the situation at a bare minimum, if you don't give them that, then it just feels like, me personally, I'm being a jerk to you because I think you're... because I've run out of ideas. I haven't come... I've been outsmarted, and I don't know the game well enough, or I'm not creative enough, to come up with a situation that will challenge you without just inflicting de facto limitations to your character, right? And I think it breaks down the player DM trust. They don't, like, it, A lot of, this is going to seem funny, right? But a lot of Dungeons & Dragons is about plausibility. And I know it's a game where giant scaly lizards breathe fire, and I know that it's a game where you can cast a spell and literally shoot butterflies out of your fingertips, or whatever it is. A swarm of bees will descend from the heavens and devour your enemies. But that all has a plausible, regimented, understandable framework attached to it. And yes, you're allowed to bend and twist and distort that framework, but when you step outside of it and go, oh, well, there's no reason within the framework for this to happen. It's just because I said so over here. You start to destroy the group fiction that you're all participating in and contributing in, and you undermine the player's stake or contribution or responsibility for contributing to that fiction. And it starts to become a game that is a battle of personalities rather than a joint construction of a storyline, of a world, of character, right? So when you say, I don't have a good reason for this, this is just, well, it just works that way. The players don't have that kind of agency, right? And what you're doing is you're highlighting your DM fiat power, and you're literally lording it over them. And they don't have any recourse other than to kind of like question you, player's DM, and now you're out of the fiction. Now we're having this meta discussion about like, well, I don't think that doesn't really seem very balanced. That's the next thing you're going to hear out of a player's mouth if you drop too many of these like DM pronouncements. Well, I don't think that's really balanced, or, you know, well, if that's true, then why wouldn't, you know, they start trying to like square it within the framework. Like, okay, well, if that's, how does it work? This is, you know, this is the view of the players, but they have to accept what you've constructed. And when you step outside that construction, you're telling them, oh, all of the stuff that I've fed you previously doesn't matter. That's not going to help you. There's no advantage. There's no benefit to you as a player to buying into the joint fiction that we've created, because I can break that at any time. And player confidence breaks down, player investment breaks down, and people start to feel personally put upon, like, this isn't working, why is this happening? And they divorce themselves from the actual play experience. And it gets much more into the interpersonal dynamics. How can I convince the DM that this isn't right? I'm not saying don't do it. I'm just saying you have to be very careful with it. And this is a particularly old school module. One of my friends posted a photo of a gas spore, you know, and it's this beholder-like creature that when you hit it with your sword, it explodes basically like a trap, right? And it doesn't make any sense until you view it through the prism of Gary was trying to trick somebody into attacking it and using their metagame knowledge of, like, that's a beholder, we have to kill it, against them. Okay, you know, Gary or whoever it was who wrote the monster, like, fine. But there's definitely, like, a string of things in AD&D where they created stuff just to hamstring people who had memorized the monster manual, who knew what stat, you know, all the stat blocks were and what all the tricks and weaknesses and vulnerabilities were. And you'll see that in a ton of places. You'll see that in Temple of Elemental Evil. I think it's more an artifact of the time period and where we were at with the hobby and the dynamic of players, especially players versus DM, which was not a very unusual play style. You know, we've talked about this before, how D&D comes out of this wargaming thing where it's like, I set up the scenario and you try and defeat it, right? That's where we were. I feel like modern role-playing is a far more collaborative process between the GM and the players. It allows for much more agency on the player's part in contributing to the story. It is about a mutual journey that you craft together rather than I'm the DM mastermind and I have put all of my little chess pieces on the field and, oh, by the way, all of the pawns move like knights. Sometimes, because I said so, right? Or whatever. So, it's important to look at this material as a product of its time, but then also think to your, the challenge I see is, how do I either justify this or tweak, alter this so that it doesn't seem as much of a DM railroad job, right? So, Shadzar is violently disagreeing with me that, maybe not violently, that is because of the players, not the game, that the players have a competitive mindset. Is that what your contention is, that it's not baked into the game that the game is competitive, that's something that the players bring to the table? That would be my question. Oh, players couldn't stop metagaming. Yeah, I think that's probably true too. I mean, you also have to consider that I think there's a lot of early AD&D that treated the game like a war game experience with marginal or very little role playing. And I think we've gotten a long way away from that now, where there's a lot of role playing that goes on in Iron Keep Chronicles, and I think I've probably done more role playing there than maybe I have at a ton of other tables throughout the history of my career. But yeah, I think in those early days there was a ton of metagaming going on. And no, again, Shadzar, you need to be a little more eloquent effusive in making your point here. There's still many players that can't stop metagaming. Yeah, I mean, I think that's true. Especially if you play Adventurers League, there's, you know, everybody, not everybody, but there's a certain amount of metagaming that happens. You know, what's the root cause of that? A variety of factors. I don't know that I can pin it down to like three off the top of my head. Other than, I'll try, let's see. AD&D treated the game like you and your group decide what you did. But there are no rules for role-playing. You decided. You had to supply the role-playing. The game can only give you the world mechanics. I'm going to disagree with that. I mean, that, I think you can develop role playing, or you can develop game mechanics that can encourage role playing. I don't think that AD&D took that approach. Now, what do I specifically mean by that? A couple things. The main example I would give would be Fate, right? So in Fate, your character doesn't really have ability scores. I mean, in Fate Accelerated, they do, but like in a game of Fate Core, you have aspects, things about your character that are true. The greatest swordsman in all of Iron Master. Okay. Now, that means things. That means the guy's a really great swordsman. Is he the best swordsman? No, because it's clearly qualified by the fact that he's the greatest swordsman in all of Iron Master, which is a town. He's not the greatest swordsman of the Sword Coast or the greatest swordsman in the world. Fate gives you the mechanics to compel things based on that role-playing attribute. Like that game mechanic, those game mechanics can evoke role-playing or get your character in trouble. AD&D, even all the way down to D&D, like our current version, doesn't give you a ton of mechanics that evoke role-playing. You can solve the game, quote-unquote, by making die rolls without having to be a particularly great role player or really do any role playing. And we've certainly all been at that table. And to be fair, like, role playing is its own reward, right? And if you choose to pursue a lot of role playing, then you will probably get a lot out of it. If you choose to sit back and talk about your character in the third person, my guy's going to go over there and he's going to attack the orc. You don't put a lot of description into it. You don't put a lot of spin into it. That's fine if that's your style of game. But nothing in AD&D, you know, forces you to roleplay more. In Fate, you can't really get away with that, right? Certainly not to the same degree. So I would argue that there are game mechanics that you could introduce which would help evoke more player investment in role-playing and character description and imaginative play that contributes to the group experience. You know, in Fate, I can create assets. I'm going to grab this crate and smash it against the big glass panel filled with chemicals. I want to start a fire. Okay, great. There's not a lot of mechanics that, you know, you don't have to do a whole lot in order to make that happen. It's not a ton, you know, I don't have to, like, okay, make a strength check, and then, like, AD&D, that gets a little weird, right? But Fate is a lot looser with the fiction and lets you make this cool thing, make this cool situation. a game that forces a playstyle on you is a bad game. I don't know that I would put that blanket statement out there. But I also don't think that, like, I don't know how to address that particular. I feel like we're sort of like losing the focus here, but I want to go back to, I don't think at the heart of the issue is there are things in White Plume Mountain that break the rules. And clearly they were inserted for a reason. Maybe it was to surprise the players. Maybe it was to put the players at a tactical disadvantage. Maybe it was to shake up the context and really make players feel like, oh, well, we're in this, you know, put players under the kind of intense suspense of like, well, everything that we know could be wrong. But it, you know, White Plume Mountain is very definitely like a DM tricks kind of dungeon in a much lesser way, but similar to Tomb of Horrors. There's this, you're put in this bad situation and things can go really wrong for you, and your conventional ways out are not, your conventional options are not available to you. You might consider that like you might consider that an advanced level of play. That's fine. I mean, I think that's what it's there for, is to challenge players who are already steeped in the game, have learned. The hardest, one of the biggest barriers that D&D has to growing wider acceptance, or at least to hooking newbies, because this is where it really like comes in hard, is that it's got this history behind it of like, when you see a beholder, when you see a round floating creature with a giant eye and all these eye stalks, don't talk to it, don't approach it, like run away from it. Like when you're your first level, you should know that, right? There's this whole body of lore that is behind Dungeons & Dragons, and when somebody new sits down and tries to enter that world, they don't have the context or the experience to know that you should be carrying a silvered weapon with you. That's the, like the classic example. Well, do you have a silver dagger? Why? Well, we could run into werewolves. How do you know that? Well, now you've created this like schism between the newbie and then the Grognard player's like, oh, why are you doing that? Right? And I think that's a huge issue with D&D is it's encumbered by its history. I mean, I don't know that there's a ton of ways out of that. That's partly cultural in terms of if you sit down at a table and there's new players there, you have to be aware of whether you're going to be that guy who drops that piece of, I don't know, you might think that it's friendly advice, but it could actually come across like very like off-putting, like, oh, okay, I didn't know. Now that person, instead of trying to be a hero like everybody else at the table, now they're pushed back. They feel lower status. So, all right. BSB Care says you got to be careful with Grognard splaining. I mean, that's sort of like that's the situation that I'm talking about. And now, to be fair, I think a lot of that is sort of going away with the amount of actual plays that are online, and people can like watch D&D and learn and kind of like understand and have a better idea. And I think that as game systems have kind of multiplied and become more diverse, and there's different influences, and everybody's experiencing more things than just playing D&D, and also as D&D has gotten more approachable, right? I mean, I don't think it's the most approachable system necessarily right out of the gate, but the greatest asset that a D&D had was also its greatest deficiency, which is that it took a couple years to learn how to play. Maybe that's exaggerating it, but it took a good 6 months, and you had to learn from somebody who already knew, right? You couldn't just you and your buddy sit down and go through the book and instantly play and fun, have a fun game together, right? You might think it was incredibly dense, and it took a lot of time and effort, and there were a lot of weird subsystems that all worked differently, and a lot of different pieces that all had to come together in order for you to master that system. So you really had to put some effort into it. Now, what that did was built a huge amount of like brand loyalty, right? Of course, once you've invested all of this time, you know the ins and outs of the systems, you're going to stick to it. There's a lot of nostalgia there. But it also created a barrier to entry where somebody new would sit down at the table and they weren't at the same level as you, and you're like, okay, look, just follow us. Okay, just follow us. Now I think D&D has gotten away from the psionic system is one thing, and druid spells are all on this particular list, and everybody has a different XP level, and all that AD&D stuff that I grew up with and embraced and indulged in. A lot of that stuff has been swept aside and simplified, streamlined, standardized. Everybody uses the same XP table. Everybody has the same proficiency bonus, right? If the fighter gets extra attack, it's because he has an extra attack ability or whatever. But you don't have this weird like three every two rounds, like all of that arcane stuff. There are skill checks. You can make up skills that will fit into the game, and everybody will go, oh, that's wisdom based? Great, boom, they can just plug it in. So the game has also gotten easier and more approachable, and that's a big benefit. So I don't mean to like pronounce like D&D's death knell. That's on its face untrue. But I think it has gotten more approachable, but there was certainly a time where it was incredibly dense and intimidating, right? So, all right. I'm not sure that we 100% explored that topic, but just my own personal recap is I think when your agency as the DM, your authority as the DM is a very powerful tool. You have inarguably the most powerful role at the table. You can overrule what happens. You can change the circumstances of a combat right in the middle of it. You can decide the player's fate seemingly at whim, if you will. But you're entering into an agreement of trust with your players when you all sit down. And that agreement is, I will challenge you in ways that are fair and appropriate, and you will hopefully rise to the challenge and then be rewarded for it, whether it be XP or gold, reputation, magic items, whatever it might be. But there's an inherent contract there that I'm going to set an array of forces against you. I'm going to present you with a series of challenges. And you will either be able to, through clever play, clever use of your powers and tactics, defeat them, or be smart enough to go, we should avoid this. Go someplace else. Right? So, that's the thing. And BSB Care says, you know, you can't abuse your authority because it really is your reputation, but you can't completely let it go. I mean, the game won't let you let it go, right? You could try to DM and just let the players do whatever you want. But as our discussion with Yes And went a couple weeks ago, was it last week? That's not the way the game's set up. That's not the way the power structure is arranged. So... all right. Well, I mean, as we go forward prepping White Plume Mountain, we're going to have more discussion about this particular situation. And I don't know that it's... I don't want to say something like, well, the module is broken, right? I don't think that's true. I think you have to look at those situations and go, all right, is this justified? Is this necessary? And likewise, now through the prism of all of our years of experience and where we're at in our particular game, is there a way that I can make this more justified or create a twist on it that makes it more naturally integrated with the playstyle of what my particular group is? All right. I would like to get into talking about our chat rewards a little bit today, but we've gone a little bit over time here, and honestly, we've had the air conditioning off for the past hour and a half, so it's getting a little greasy in here, as you may well have noticed. I will say we did a bunch of significant changes to the, you know, we really threw things in a different direction. We went more of a wild carbs style. Donation goals, and you know, one of the things that I struggle with is I was hoping to get to a place where we could have one set of donation stuff, and it would sort of, like, once that was locked in, it would carry over from week to week to week, and I don't know if that's actually a reasonable goal or not. I don't know if that's feasible, but that's what I was hoping for. Right now, the way Wildcards works is a lot of them are sort of created from week to week with ideas of where the story is going. And I don't know that I have the foresight in order to do that the same way when we're using a published adventure, the same way that Jordan does when he's creating his story from whole cloth and taking it in whatever direction that he wants. And he has, you know, ideas for where the story is going to flow to, but he's not literally reading from a book, this is what's going to happen next. But we got to the place where we've got, you know, the lucky break and the dark turn and the discovery. And I think that those are going to work well going forward. You know, we'll just continue to explore that and see where that leads us. You know, it's something that we're tinkering with. We don't want you to feel like we're leaving rewards on the table and, you know, you guys have contributed for something and then it didn't get used. So we want to kind of avoid that situation. On the other hand, we want you to feel like, well, your contributions do have an effect in the storyline. And I think they did last night, so I think it worked out. It's just something that I would like to hear your feedback on here in the next time we sit down, and something that we're no doubt going to tinker with going forward. But that's just kind of parenthetically, like, where we're at, why there was the change, why you didn't see some of the things like the Lords of the Iron Keep come out last night and that sort of thing. So this is a little bit simpler. It also requires a little bit more jujitsu on my part in terms of working those twists and turns into the adventure. That's fine. We're going to have a little DM challenge every now and then, right? All right, let's take a look. Yeah, BSB Care says, it's a matter of trust, and we trust that you will have those unlocked rewards pay off at a future date if it's not in that particular session. So I appreciate that flexibility. That certainly makes things easier for me. I also want to be able to, like, call out and highlight, well, this is where, you know, the players got a lucky break. This is where there was a discovery, etc. Not necessarily call that out in the session, but I want it to be something that chat can certainly, like, feel like, oh, okay, this is where this is happening. All right, let's take a quick break at the rest of the calendar. Tonight is Mr. David Krenn's Star Wars game, Fantasy Flight, Edge of the Empire. Never tell me the odds. I'm not sure what's on deck for tonight. I don't know if it's another one-off or if they've got some continuing storyline to go. Friday is Call of Cthulhu Black Bag Vikings with Mr. Wes Otis. And then you have the weekend off to catch us up on the YouTube. So whether that is going back and watching last night's D&D game or watching Monday night's Buffy game or what have you, getting caught up in all your disorganized play, that's your left to your own recognizance. If you are here in the greater Los Angeles area Saturday night at the Upright Citizens Brigade space, I believe on Sunset, I will be sitting in and DMing for the Bearded Men West. I will be doing Dungeons & Dragons, the improvised campaign. I'm not sure who our hero is going to be, but if you have not seen one of our live shows, UCB is a great venue, and I really encourage you to get some tickets and come out and see the show, because I love doing the show over on Geek & Sundry, but there's something about doing it live in front of a crowd that just sort of, like, the whole atmosphere gets amped up when you can hear everybody's reactions right there, like live in the room, and it's happening. So that's coming up on Saturday night. Next Tuesday, I have bad news for you. One of those callbacks paid off for me. I will be working on Tuesday, and unfortunately, I will not be home to do disorganized play. I may try to schedule something in and do a replacement session, but I haven't committed to that at this point. So for right now, for sure, Tuesday is going to be open. We're not going to have disorganized play on Tuesday, but I will be available on Wednesday and come back, and we'll delve further into White Plume Mountain. So yes, thanks for your good wishes. You know, if it pans out and I make the cut, you will see me, however briefly, perhaps on your television viewing screen of your own personal choice. Coming up sometime in September, I hope. So, that's... Oh, yeah! Avril Pant planted those seeds. Yes, that's gotta come back too, right? Yeah, we need to definitely update our plot radar and then take a look ahead. You know, the other challenging thing about White Plume Mountain is that there's basically three independent forks, and they could go down any of them at this point. And I wish I just had an idea of, like, that's the one. So, I don't know. I may try and... I may do some selective editing and make it something like, well, you can't open doors two or three until you've gotten the key out of door one or something like that. I don't know. The other thing that we need to do, of course, is look at the schedule, because in a couple weeks, Gen Con is coming up. We will be dark for that. Everybody's going to Gen Con. And then not too long after Gen Con, we have Tomb of Annihilation coming out. And I think we're going to transition pretty quickly from White Plume Mountain into Tomb of Annihilation, which that will be, I think that'll be a nice change of pace, because Tomb of Annihilation is such a huge sandbox-style adventure that it will give us a little more freedom to breathe and go places and explore and create relationships with new NPCs, and it'll feed the player's need for interaction a little bit more, you know, and develop the storyline in a little bit more organic fashion than this hardcore dungeon crawling has done. So, Fawkwad, you hit it on the head. Was I cast as creepy neighbor or awkward coworker? Ding, 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 awkward coworker. I'm still working on my villainous debut as the creepy neighbor. So, that's the buzz, everybody. Thank you so much. I apologize for the power outage in the middle of the stream, but thanks so much for sticking with me and coming back and taking part in today's GM prep session. I will be back, like I said, come see Dungeons & Dragons the Improvised Campaign on Saturday night if you are here in town. If you're not, I will be back on Wednesday. Follow me at dungeonbastard.com. If you have a question, suggestion, anything like that, you can certainly fling it to me over on Twitter, and I will tackle it as I can. Otherwise, follow us on social, back our Patreon. End of the month is coming up. It's a good time to get your pledge in. Thanks, everybody, for tuning in last night. Thanks to Fawkwad for modding and everybody, all of our regulars who've made it such a friendly space for all of our new visitors. Until next time, let's dungeon! 173 in a row!